Hey there, travelers. Today we're going to explore the vast expanse of the land of Athens. Perhaps you want to take in a fight at the gladiator arenas of the beautiful city of Tyre. The Sea of Silt is a resource for all of your sand-based needs. As we say in Athens, the sun is so dark, we gotta wear shades. So let's explore the world of Dark Sun together on WebDM. This is what you do. You take the war engines from Avernus.
Yeah.
And you put them in Dark Sun.
You could do that. Yeah, I mean, that's Mad Max.
And that's your Mad Max.
Yeah, I imagine there's a lot of stuff in Avernus that you'd want to port over. But, like, Mad Max and Dark Sun is not... I mean, that's the comparison kind of from the beginning, I think, for Dark Sun. Because they're, like... One of the things that I learned while we're researching for the subject was, like, the development that this setting went through and the fact that it sort of, like, started out as this thing called War World... Which was going to be, I remember the battle system, actually.
Yeah.
There was battle system, they remade Chainmail later on. There's always these, like, war games attached to D&D through TSR's era.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was, Birthright was being another.
Yeah, I'm glad that was the first draft, though.
Oh, right. War World.
What if it's like War of the Worlds, but we get rid of
War World, yeah. So Dark Sun was supposed to, like, tied into this battle system. It was supposed to be a harsh, brutal world in which everyone was at war all the time and yada, yada, yada. You know the drill. But they were going to get rid of the traditional Tolkien-esque... They were going to scrub D&D clean of all of its D&D-isms with Dark Sun and present something new and fresh and weird and alien.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
What a leap forward it would have been.
Right. And then, the marketing departments were like, no, you got to have elves and dwarves and things like that. So that's what I found interesting, because whenever I was creating Land Between Two Rivers and sort of like I wanted a campaign setting that was different and didn't lean on the traditional tropes or twisted them in some way, and I like knew Dark Sun was out there. I'd never played it, never owned any of the books. I just was like, I know that. And as I started researching it and spending time on, say, the Burnt World of Athas, which is like the place to go for Dark Sun stuff and the like, it was like, wow, my campaign setting and this are remarkably similar. Like, we got to the same place through very different means.
Yeah.
And we have different assumptions, but like the core fundamental details of the setting are pretty much the same. It's a ruined world that has been specifically ruined by the use of magic. It is a world in which the races of that world have been fundamentally changed by ecological disaster and magical catastrophe on their planets. Arcane magic is reviled.
How about them gods?
Right, there are no gods. The natural flora and fauna that have survived have been changed and mutated and made more fantastical by their survival.
But do you have cannibal halflings?
I don't have cannibal halflings.
So you're safe from copyright infringement.
Yeah,
that's the only thing I was getting at.
Yeah, I don't, there's no, and the elves are a bit different. No, there's only three humans total so far. All of them have been player characters, and one of them has been sent back home. So technically, it's just two.
Oh, they sent Axtreamer home?
No, not Axtreamer. Oh. Flash. It was one of the one-shots. Someone was playing a 1940s, like, Rocketeer.
Oh, the Rocketeer. Right.
Pack and the 9mm or the 45s.
Dual-wielding pistols.
Yeah, we got sent back home in a chaos surge. As I was developing Land Between Two Rivers over many years and actually running it the last few years, it's like, I've come to appreciate Dark Sun more and really kind of look at it as a source of inspiration. To me, what I like about it is that it's not, like, the trappings of it are not standard D&D, but the world is very D&D, right? Like, you can see it all over the, it's really, it's a pulp world.
It's very pulp. It's very science fantasy a bit.
Yeah.
With some of the races and just, like, however, like, just the... how everything is psychic.
Yes.
Well, not everything, but
most everything
is, though, right?
I mean, plants sometimes. The plants that are left that didn't get defiled and turned to ash. But, they would need to be to resist magic. And you would need... So it sort of like took that... The world is dangerous. The world is brutal, oppressive. And like everything has adapted to that. Because part of the appeal to me of Dark Sun is that it has that ancientness. It has that... antiquity to it, but as opposed to, say, Forgotten Realms, where the antiquity is in all the different places you can go and delve in, and the influence of the elves on the world, and then the 8 or 9 dwarven empires, which, like, all of this weight of history is in there in the Forgotten Realms, and it's there for you to explore and make use of. But in Dark Sun, it's largely, you might never encounter it at all. You might never get any of that. It just explains how the world got to where it is and and the like. So it's old. It's an ancient, old world.
Yeah.
The sorcerer kings, these sort of evil, oppressive magic users and mages and psionicists that rule over the city-states of the region that Dark Sun's set in. It's not even the whole world. It's just like a piece of it.
Yeah. Like this like crater almost.
Yeah.
Surrounded by these tall mountains.
Really tall mountains.
That could be like the rim of this giant magical explosion. I don't know.
There's hints of green along the edge of the map, right?
Yeah.
You know, and that's where, of course, the cannibal halflings live.
Yeah. Don't go to the green place in this Mad Max. you'll encounter more than just biker grandmas.
Right. You know, but you know, it's set on the edge of a silt sea, and these sorcerer kings sort of rule it, and it's got the Barsoomian or Clark Ashton Smith feel to it. It's very like pulp fantasy and sword and sandals and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And of course, heavily influenced by the artist Brahm.
Oh, God.
It is Brahm. It is Brahm. You know, you really are very few times has there been like an artist and a campaign setting that have so perfectly matched one another and so effectively communicated what this place is about. Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm thinking of the one piece where it's like a, you know, a gladiatrix on the prow of some sort of sand sailing ship, and there's other like raiders or gladiators there, and you're just like, I need to know who these people are. What's this encounter? How do my players come across this? Mm-hmm. I ran across it actually the first time, even long before I got into D&D, I was into D&D trading cards, which were a thing back in the early 90s.
Oh, how hipster of you.
Yeah, right.
I was into D&D cards before.
Right. And so you could buy these trading cards that would have like iconic characters and settings and sort of locations and things like that. I don't think they read stats on them, but maybe they did. And I was always taken by the Brahm art because it's like so different than everything else. Here's something that could be out of a fairy tale painting. You know, a knight with flowing pennants. He's fighting some sort of classic dragon.
Yeah, yeah.
And then there's these half naked, you know, wielding bone and carapace weapons fighting in a desolate wasteland or just by themselves.
Yeah, those are the ones that I love. Like the lone figure whether it's the one where it's the guy and he's got the axe or whatever above his head.
Yeah, yeah,
Or the riding the solitary mount, which totally Mandalorian. For that first episode. Nice little homage to.
Right.
Those are the ones that I love because it just kind of portrays the desolation.
Yeah.
Like it's just you out there.
Yeah, yeah. Even some of the fourth edition Dark Sun art was really effective in terms of like getting across what this place looks like. Actually, now that I think about it, some of the fourth edition Dark Sun art is really cool for like, just what do they wear? What do they look like? Because everything about the setting, you'd need to recalibrate your expectations and what it looks like because this is a world that has been ruined by the use of magic over countless millennia. They knew it. They knew that using magic drained the natural world of life and vitality. They knew that doing that is what was going to break this place.
And they didn't do anything about it.
Not only did they not do anything about it, but they were like, yeah, that's fine with us because that's how we become immortal. And so it's a setting that's been ruined by like a handful of people seeking immortality.
Yeah. Against the will and knowledge of like 97% of the sages in it.
Yeah, and the gods and whoever else, whatever else was going on.
So we could learn something from it is what you're saying.
Certainly, yeah. The ecological, fragility and the kind of, well, to talk about that, that is explicitly there in Lamb Tree Two Rivers. But
yeah,
I think it's there in Dark Sun as well, is that, the sorcerer kings desired power and immortality for themselves and they did not care who or what they destroyed to get it. Mm-hmm. Of course, that's ancient history by the time we get to actual play. But part of the reason I bring this up is because Dark Sun was also one of the first, actually maybe the first, that really had a meta plot and used the meta plot as a way to tie in the game setting with the novels and the like. And metaplot is a controversial and reviled kind of element of gaming's past. You don't really catch a lot of it anymore, as far as I'm aware of. Maybe there are games out there that still make use of metaplot, but I'm not aware of them. Of course, White Wolf was famous for its metaplots. You know, it's almost why you were played Old World of Darkness was to kind of get some of that.
But
Dark Sun was very much, you know, some of the first adventures start advancing the timeline of the setting. So the original box set, it's like, all right, Tyr is this one region of the world. It's controlled by one sorcerer king. It's on the verge of social revolt. So there's going to be a slave rebellion and all this. And the first adventure, Freedom, is about the player sort of participating in some of that, being present for it. And then the adventures and novels start feeding into one another. And within like 5 years of it being released, they released a second boxed set that had factored in the meta plot, and it's completely sort of different. And if you're a fan of like D&D settings, you'll notice this happens frequently. Sometimes like Greyhawk is another setting that they'd advance the timeline for, and then everybody gets upset and they don't like it. It's not what happened in their campaign, etc. To me, it's interesting because like this is the one of the first instances of it. So I'm curious if how this was handled influenced other versions of Metaplot. To me, that's all, you know, it's a whole different show or whatever, but it came prepackaged with this assumption that the world is going to continue on and going to develop, and you can be a part of it if you want, but you know, or you can just play it as is. Of course, I think just playing it as is and ignoring the meta plot or just using what you want is the way to go. But you know, that's
well, yeah. But I mean, I don't know. I kind of like the idea of them just saying this is because it's showing that this is a living, progressing world. Like events happen, and if you want to use them. If not, who cares?
Right.
But I don't know. To get angry about it seems just like there isn't a disclaimer that says if you don't use this, you know, this material will self-destruct.
I always try to keep in mind that there are gaming groups that are very much committed to whatever's in the official rules is what we're going with. And so I can understand for them anything that has the appearance of officiality, they would want to be careful about. You know, for us, it's just like, yeah, I'm not going to.
Who cares?
I'm curious. You know, one of my, not complaints, but just sort of things that irk me about the way that the 5th edition modules have been put together is if we're setting them all on Forgotten Realms, like what does this look like? Are they one after the other, like show me how they impact the world.
Yeah, because of the way you set them up, they all did impact another. And you basically created a meta plot, like
I did,
in it, which makes sense. One could lead to the other, and that's why you know. Then the giants go in revolt, and blah blah blah. And,
why not?
The souls are getting sucked away. And
sucks to be on Faerun right now. Sucks to be on Athas.
Sucks to be on Athas anytime.
Certainly, we have this world Athas. We're really only getting a snapshot of this one location. It's sort of the iconic. Everything's a desert. City states, I think there's, I'm not gonna remember them all, but you know, there's like 6 or 7, and they're all a little bit different. They all have a different character. You know, the one thing that binds them is their sort of iron rule that they have over the populace, partially because you know there's no gods.
Yeah. Well, the sorcerer's king have.
Sorcerer kings, yes. The sorcerer kings have sort of an iron rule over the populace. Mm-hmm. There are no gods. They heavily regulate the use of psionics.
You know, disclaimer: like slavery is like a commonplace.
Very
thing.
Common. Yep.
It is everywhere.
Yeah.
So you know, however that is received at your table, just keep that in mind.
Yeah. It's one of those things where you know I like it because it's like. You know, you have the opportunity to overthrow this system. You have the opportunity, the equilibrium that exists in a setting like this that the players are going to disrupt, even if you don't use the meta plot, is an equilibrium that is deserving of disruption.
Right.
It's an equilibrium that suggests oppression and violence and brutality. And the players, by virtue, or the characters, by virtue of the fact that they've got players that are at or removed from this imaginary place, can be like, no, we could have hope, and we could have compassion, we could have humanity, something. Let's get rid of these demigod-like sorcerer kings. Make no mistake, they're usually, second edition, they'd have 20 levels and multiple classes. You know, they usually like,
no, they're badasses.
Yeah, 20 level wizards and psionicists, plus a bunch of other powers. One of them's an actual dragon. And it's just so powerful that it's just like, I don't even need a city state of people worshiping me. I'm just going to be out here in the wastes and don't ever come across me. Mm-hmm. I think it's the only dragon in the setting. So it's a world for, you know, if your characters or if your players like fighting for things that are hopeful, fighting for things that are good, fighting against something, you know, Dark Sun can be really grimdark. It is dark fantasy, but you can tone down some of those elements and then give them something to fight against that can last the whole campaign, multiples.
Yeah, I mean, it's already, since it's already baked into the setting, there's this Well, I mean, like anything, when you see a resource scarcity, like that's when you see people fighting, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And so the fact that, you know, resources are like the land is barren.
Yeah.
And just the fact of like the way magic works.
Yes. Yeah.
Is you know, that's a whole thing. It's already reviled.
Right.
But there are still people out there casting arcane spells.
They certainly are.
And just like killing the last rose in the valley just to cast a fireball.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. And like everyone knows as well, because like living beings, they don't take so back up a bit, what Pruitt's talking about is the fact that arcane magic is known as defiling.
Yeah.
And the arcane spellcaster draws energy to cast magic from the natural world. Most of the time it's just plants, but living creatures that are around them will experience like some sensation of pain or discomfort. At the very least, they know that a little bit's been taken off the top to fund this magic, and therefore you can't like cast anonymously. You know, people will know when magic is being, you know, in use because, you know, they'll see its effects.
It's kind of like the Highlander. You just kind feel the quickening.
You can just feel it, yeah. And even preserving magic, which does not draw its life force from the natural world, is still seen as like, no, this is magic.
It's coming from somewhere.
It's coming from somewhere. Yeah. And defiling is always an option. So in second edition, they were two sort of separate classes. And their approach to magic was... you know, divided between them, but in subsequent, the unofficial third edition, and then going forward, it's just a mode of casting. Anybody can be a defiler if you cast arcane spells. Anyone can tap into this. And so I like that idea. I like the idea of there being two modes of casting.
Oh, yeah.
You know, where...
Well, it really gives you the choice. Like, how bad do you really want to cast the spell?
Yeah, like, how bad do you want to cast it? Yeah. And we've got some folks on our Mortal Discord who are playing a Dark Sun campaign, and they tell these great stories about how there's, you know, trying to cast spells and drawing just a little bit of energy from everybody.
Every PC.
I got to take a little bit of this so I can do this lightning bolt. Or
everybody gets a migraine for a second. Like, right. Oh, damn it.
And so it's this, it's different in that sense. But at the same time, psionics are extremely common. Mm-hmm. And so common that they, you know, have laws regarding their use. There's customs in the setting for how mind control is treated.
I mean, a whole race of humans kind of branched off because they're all psionic.
Because they're all psionic, yeah. Especially as an influence of second and fourth, third and fourth edition on the game, new things were added in. One of those were like the Alan and some others. But, you know, orders of psychics who monitor other psychics. And certainly those in one of the city states, because the Sorcerer Kings don't want anything that's going to challenge their power, including high-level psionics, psionicists that have their own idea about what's going on.
an order of minders.
An order of minders, yes.
Something like that.
Yeah. you know, because at the same time, like, there's no gods, right? So clerics get their powers from the inner planes. Now, in prior editions, second edition, when you played a cleric, you got access to what were called spheres. And they're kind of like domains in that they encompass a theme. But it's just related to the spells you have access to. So the concept, the idea that you play a cleric and you get access to the entire cleric spell list was not really there in second edition. Instead, you got access to whatever spheres your god's portfolio included. And every cleric spell would list what spheres it was a part of in addition to its spell school. When Dark Sun came out and, you know, it's got clerics but there's no gods, then the spheres that they were limited to were the elemental spheres, which at the time were incredibly, you know, it really sort of was a nerf to clerics in that sense. And then the more traditional cleric was replaced by a figure known as the Templar, which received their power direct through the Sorcerer Kings and were their agents and were kind of sort of like the bureaucrats and magistrates of the city-states. That got flipped around in 4th edition because of the way power sources worked, and divine power is not there at all. And so clerics, even though they're a divine class, were become primal and sort of everything gets shuffled around. But one of the consequences is that Templars are now arcane casters who are more akin to warlocks than anything. They pact with their sorcerer.
Sounds right, right?
King, right, yeah, and have access to certain powers. Although I do, like, there was a third edition campaign setting, Midnight, that had a similar setup. There, an evil god had won and taken over the planet, and the only clerics were clerics to this god. no other, you know, people with the power to channel divine will could channel anything other than this Isridore's, I think, power. And so I kind of like that. I kind of like maybe if I was going to do it, we can talk a bit more about that in a minute, but like if I was going to do it, I might say like, no, Templars are clerics and there's just not any other clerics. Like they're all either druids or something else. So I don't know, that's kind of like a broad overview of just the setting in general. You want to talk about some of the mechanics, or is there anything that you think we left out of just?
Well, I mean, you know, just maybe like? Just touching on some of the races that populate the world.
Oh yeah, certainly, yeah.
I mean, we did mention the Elan. I mean, there are some fantasy the bulk of the fantasy races are there.
They make them put them all back in because it's a you know. It's a D&D product.
Meh, you know, whatever. But I mean, it is set up for, you know, like a fifth edition, you know, like moles, half giants.
Oh, so yeah.
I mean, those are Goliaths, right?
Yeah, half giants certainly are definitely Goliaths. I think in probably fourth edition, they were just called Goliaths. Moles are interesting. They're a human dwarf hybrid. And this is another concept that I've taken from Dark Sun and used in sort of other worlds, the concept of a sorcerously bred slave soldier. I call them thralls in the worlds that I use, and they have won their freedom to varying degrees. But similar here with moles, half giants sometimes, they are you know, created by the sorcerer kings to be gladiators, to be laborers, to be you know, servile. And you know, that idea of playing a you know, playing someone who's part of this artificially constructed species of people. Who have a purpose and you know, there's a reason they exist alongside those who are just like, yeah, I just was born and I mean, I don't know how humans came to live here.
Yeah. You know, I'm just a dust breather out here. You know?
Yeah. But you know, you on the other hand are someone where, like, you know, you don't have to worry or wonder. You've got the certainty of it, but like, it's not a pleasant or reassuring certainty.
Right.
That appeals to me for a lot of reasons. So like the moles, the half giants, they really really like their addition.
Yeah, I love the Thrycreen. Because any kind of like mantis or insectoid people, I just love.
Really,
and the fact that they're psychic mantis, manti.
The insect people really give it that alienist. I think that in like the Thrycreen and the Arakokra and the Terrans, you can see how they were going for these monstrous humanoids that have survived on you know, through all the purges and the cleansings and the defilings, and now we're here. But then, you know, we've got standard. Kind of like standard elves, dwarves, although they're changed up enough so that they're almost kind of like in the same way that Eberron includes the hallmark you know, class races from D&D, but offers a twist. Elves, dwarves, halflings, and the like are similarly twisted.
Yeah.
Dark Sun.
And then the Drey were introduced.
Dragonborn. Sure. Yeah.
And the Eladrin.
That would have been in fourth edition.
Yeah, like these psychic isolationist kind of assholes that live at the edge. It's just like
I was like Eladrin. Yeah. The later editions, I'm much less familiar with than some of those in the original. But like just the treatment of elves in general as hostile, xenophobic. You know, they're nomads. They're known for being long distance runners.
Like the Tata Umata in Mexico.
Yeah, and but also just being, you know, very much sort of keep to themselves.
Yeah.
Is one of those things that's like, it's okay, that's an elf thing, but it's the nomad part, the sort of being violent about keeping others out, that's different.
And then of course, protecting their green. You got those freaking cannibal halflings, dinosaur riding.
Well, that's the Eberron.
Oh, sorry. I conflated it. My bad. Maybe they have dinosaurs. Who knows?
But
still, they're cannibals. Mm-hmm. And I'm sorry, if something's coming at me that's 3 feet tall and wants to eat my hamstrings, it's going to make me run that much faster.
Yeah, this is the Hills Have Eyes shit. Cannibal halflings are what always get brought up when you mention Dark Sun. I really don't know much more about them. That they're cannibal halflings. I mean, can imagine.
Jim, do you need to know anything else?
Not really. I mean, like, are they savagely cannibal? Are they just like, no, we eat a living creature? Here's the other thing. Are they cannibal against themselves? Or like, if they're just like cannibal against other like humans and dwarves, then why are they cannibals and not just carnivores?
I mean, I bet that when the going gets tough, they start looking at each other.
Yeah.
But I mean, a human, that's like two halflings.
Why would you expend the energy to...
Like a whole luau.
Yeah, it's a whole luau. That's the entire tribe getting to eat. Again, there's something about something tiny and wanting to eat you that just stirs the fires of
well,
survival.
Especially halflings, right? Because halflings have that cutesy homebody sort of... You know, they're not supposed to be... That's like a goblin that does that. But in some sense, like, whatever happened to this world turned the halflings, who were the dominant sort of imperial power, into these savage cannibals, right? Into these monsters. Although you can play them. They are playable. So, that's sort of how they're different. Also, dwarves are hairless. They don't have beards. They don't have any eyebrows. They still have work stone and metal and the like, if you can find it.
that's one of the things, the resource scarcity. I mean, almost no metal.
No, it's that, but it extends almost beyond that, right? Like, almost no metal, but water obviously being a big deal, and to the point where it's like you'd give it out as treasure.
You find a tankard of water. Pure, clean
water. Yeah, pure, clean water. Yeah, straight.
They fight over that. Leave the long sword.
No paper, or very, you know, paper's very scarce, so in second edition, you know, every arcane caster has a spell book. I think that'd be less of a problem now. What with bards and warlocks and sorcerers and the like, but it offers those wizards an opportunity to kind of show, like, what is this? Is this etched onto bone plates held together by a string? Is it beaten into metal sheets and then formed into a crude book?
Like, I would have my spell cube. It would be a clay cube, and you'd etch your spells on each side of it.
Yeah.
And so you carry around your two or three cubes.
Yeah,
and you have to move it around, like a Rubik's cube or something like that. Maybe it's just because I read Snow Crash and I'm thinking about the Sumerian civilization. Anyway. Yeah.
But, like, while we're talking about classes, there were a lot of mechanical changes the game made to make it stand out from its peers.
It did.
Classes were one of those areas. We both did a little bit of research into it, just kind of familiarize yourself.
Well, I mean, I want to play a gladiator. It looks fun in its own way. It's, like, just as a separate class, kind of than just, like, a fighter or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, I look at that, and I'm just like, yeah, I want that. I want the big, like, charismatic, like, you're there to woo a crowd while slaying your opponents.
While slaying your opponents,
as opposed to just fighting for honor or whatever. I don't know. I like that.
I kind of like that too. You're like the fighter who's there for the entertainment, but you can also, like, in the context of, if you're going to start with what they're suggesting with a meta plot, then gladiators have a long history of leading revolts and rebellions and the like. And
yeah, they can garner as much sway with the masses,
Highly popular, usually, so I can see something like that, and easily modeled in fifth edition by any number of subclasses. You can make your own, you do the background, and do more like a battle master who's done the gladiator. There's so many different ways to kind of handle it.
Yeah, but also maybe coming up with a sorceress origin that, I mean, like, you are a defiler, like you are a sorceress defiler.
Yeah.
So you don't need text or anything, but you would be one of the most dangerous people out there.
Yeah, like someone who's taken defiling to the next level. Like, this planet's already dead and dying.
It's like,
this is like the next. Yeah, you got to squeeze the last bit of blood from the stone.
Wrench every last drop of magic out of this place.
Yeah. I could certainly see that.
Because I think what you could do is, since they have meta magic, what you can start doing is coming up with a meta magic where it's like you only draw from the enemies. So even the act of casting spells damages your enemies on top of the spell that you're casting. If you cast it with this meta magic. Right?
Yes. Yeah. Ooh, yeah. I like that because it's...
I mean, it'd be expensive. It would cost a lot of sorcery points to do that. But maybe that's all you need.
Yeah. Right? Well, and it's sort of one of those things where, like, a display of something like that might... is as much dangerous to the caster because it's like, who knows what you're... Who else knows that you're doing that? Who can sense that you're drawing deeper from the life force of the world or from living creatures? I really like that. Because I've been thinking about this myself. It's like, how would I mechanically handle defiling and preserving? And I do like the idea that, it's not necessarily tied to a certain class. It's something any arcane caster could do. But having one who's, like, really good at it, one who's taken it to the next level, would also really fit in with that.
I think what I would do is you take the spell level, whatever that is,
yeah,
and I don't know if you double it for the amount of hit points you need. Mm. So to cast a first level spell, you need at least 2 hit points. Mm-hmm. So whether that comes from you or comes from your component, I mean, I don't know if that's enough.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
To cast a magic missile, what is that worth?
Like, how I don't think
it should be as worth as much as damage as it deals.
Mm-hmm. We start getting into fireball territory.
Well, I mean, yeah, because I'm trying to, like, you try to look at, like, using damage as a metric to see what it's worth, but maybe, like, per die of damage, you need that many hit points worth.
Yeah, I could say something like dice of damage, and even, like, dice of damage and then rolling something to sort of extrapolate from that. I can see, like, all right, if it's 1 to 3 dice of damage, then roll like a d6 mm-hmm. or something like that. 4 to 5, you know, be higher. But even just, you know, how many dice of damage does it do? Then that's how much it tries to drain from the surrounding vegetation. And if there is none, it will seek out other sources to power itself. Mm-hmm. And this is really one of those things where it's like, if I was going to convert all this to 5th edition, I would just like bite the bullet and get that original box set.
Yeah.
And just look and see how it was handled there and convert it. Mm-hmm. But to me, the whatever method you end up using, the point is that magic has a cost that others pay.
Yeah.
And
oh, yes.
That is the big deal, is that the sorcerer doesn't necessarily have to pay that price other than to live in a world that they've ruined. Mm-hmm. But you can make others pay for your magic, and that's why it's reviled. You know, it's like
everyone will hate you.
Selfish asshole.
Hey, wizard, we need you to identify this. Can you please go over the hill before you do it?
We brought you a shrub.
Paying spells with plants.
Yeah.
Oh God. But then the other kind of mechanical thing I want to talk on is how pervasive psionics is.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Right? Like the fact, like at the beginning when you make your character, you roll to see if you have any psionic abilities.
Yeah, yeah. So you would everybody was a wild talent or potential to be a wild talent,
yeah.
Which is what they call that. You know, there's a part of me that really likes the randomness of it. Do I get this extra thing if I roll really well, if I get, you know, but at the same time I can see why that fell out of favor.
I'm sure it breeds some kind of resentment at the table if it's only just because somebody got lucky enough to get it and everyone else didn't.
And everybody didn't, or worse, it's like, oh yeah, well I made my character over the weekend and I'm a wild talent. Like I've read a lot of stories of that where it's just kind of like, really? Like that's a really small percentage.
Yeah. Wait, you rolled 3 18s and you're a wild talent?
Right. Things like that.
Or hey, you rolled a 20.
So yeah, well that's the, I mean,
we'll get into that.
As an aside, most of the horror stories I heard about people's characters in second edition almost always started with, I made this character by myself, which to me signaled something else was going on.
Yeah, group character creation. I'm sorry.
There's a reason why we started it. not overall, but in our group. Mm-hmm. We started the whole thing. It was both of us. So the psionics are all over the place. Psionicists are there. Scions. TSR era D&D, there's just like one class of scion, and then they do a bunch of stuff, and then third edition and later it gets broken up into individual classes, and I would just include them all, psychic warriors and scions, mm-hmm. and all of them. They are as common and prevalent as magic is in most D&D settings.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I feel like treating them that way is what makes Dark Sun a bit unique in that regard, and that psionics are kind of the main form of supernatural power.
Yeah. And quite honestly, if I ran a Dark Sun game now, just because I love giving people powers, because I love making the PCs feel that much different.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And, you know, in D&D, you're already a superhero anyway, basically.
Sure. Start out near...
But yeah, I would probably just, like, all my PCs, like, yeah, no, you start with a psionic ability.
Sure, yeah, yeah.
Now how often...
Keep it random.
Yeah, keep it random, you know, whether it's first to third level ability.
Uh-huh.
For, like, off the top of my head, if it was, like... There's a possibility of it being a roll a d4. 1 is cantrip, 2 is first level, 3 second, 4 3, right? If it's a cantrip, yeah, you do it at will. If it's a first level ability, maybe you do it a number of times equal to your main stat. Whatever your main stat for your class is, your strength, you got a +4 bonus, you can do it 4 times per short rest.
Right.
If it's second level ability, you do it once per short rest. Mm. And if it's a whatever ability, third level, you do it once a day. That way there's some limitation.
Yeah.
But yeah, you might have a person that can cast a fireball with their mind once a day.
Sure.
That's a fighter.
Yeah.
And like, to me, I'm like, to me, that's not really broken. Sorry.
It's like, sort of a one-use kind of thing.
It's a one-use kind of thing, once a day. And if you do that too much, people are going to start knowing what you can do. And they might start gunning for you first. Because you're already playing the game on, like, hardcore mode and survival mode, like in Dark Souls.
In second edition, the game recommended that you make a character tree.
Yeah.
Which was multiple characters and how they relate to each other, so that if one of them dies, which they might because it's really deadly, plants have psychic powers. Every creature they meet has been evolved to, be extra deadly and like, not to mention the unique monsters that they introduce. Mm-hmm. It's like you can have another one ready to go, and if I'm not mistaken, you rolled for your stats with something like 5d4. Which produces obviously a 5 through 20 range for your stats, and with a higher minimum, with a higher average, score.
And then what happens when you couple that those racial bonuses on top of that?
Right. Yeah.
Like, would you allow that? If somebody rolled a 20.
I mean, in the baseline rules, I do believe that it allowed the stats to go up to 20, which was normally not something that you could do. But I could be mistaken on that.
But would you allow them to go over 20 at character creation?
I probably
wouldn't.
For 5th edition, I really think that like even 18s at character creation is... I'm not as satisfied in those games. Like, from a DM's perspective, just you started off like so close to, anyway.
No, I'm with you.
Ultimately, I don't, if you got a 16 and you had 2 and you got an 18, I'm not going to stop you. But I think I would, have it at character creation. I probably would do standard dice rolling, for that if I was doing it for 5th edition. But maybe let you have, like, an extra +1 or something somewhere. Or if we were doing point buy, maybe an extra few points to squeeze out. Because the point of Dark Sun is that if you were a regular person, you would be enslaved.
Or dead.
Or dead. And therefore, the people who become adventurers are those who are either could escape their bonds of servitude, and therefore they are, that now they lead a life of adventure because they have to. And I imagine ex-slave would be a background that you would make for something like this. Or they, they're just people who are larger than life. Given the fact that Dark Sun relies so much on planetary romance and dying earth genre of literature, sort of science fantasy genres where individual heroes are larger than life and can kind of transcend the societal structures that they come from, that lends itself well to sort of the D&D world, because that's kind of what D&D characters do, they sort of transcend those differences. There's so much that they changed with the way classes work, with the way magic works, with the way your characters work. I just like that idea that we're going to take the same game and just see where its limits are, see what we can stretch it to do, what we can make with it, and is it still recognizably the same game? And I think Dark Sun is. You do the same things in this as you would in any other. You discover lost ruins, acquire items of power, seek to overthrow the people who are unjust and wicked and the like. Survival is a big one. Food and water would probably be the bulk of treasure you get for the first few levels. Mm-hmm. Gear, all of those kinds of things are a part of this style of play, and I'd want rules that support it, either... Mm-hmm. Making changes to rangers to make their abilities less, 100%, as we've talked about before, or just for certain backgrounds or classes, just being like, if there was food around here, you'd be really good at finding it. There's just none. You cannot feed anyone by foraging as you travel through the sea of silt, which used to be an ocean. And those rocks over there are not rocks. That's an old dead coral formation. Mm-hmm. It's a harsh world. And if you like that kind of play where making sure you've got what you need to survive, making sure you've got the gear you need and the spells and all that is interesting to you, then Dark Sun's a really cool place, I think, to adventure in.
Yeah, and again, you throw in some war engines from Avernus.
Man.
Just Mad Max. I want it. I want it so bad.
It's going to be really cool. Yes. the infernal machines from there could easily easily become elemental powered machines and the like.
Oh, totally.
There's...
Yeah, you have your elemental coins.
Yeah.
And the clerics who are primal casters are angry at you from capturing the elementals because that's where they draw their power from.
We're going to start doing this again. You're going to start the cycle again.
Now you're going to destroy the primary elements of the world.
Yeah.
Oh, come on.
Yeah. And then, you know, high-level clerics become elementals, so somebody's coming after you. Mm.
If you like the video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe.
WebDM exists thanks to our Patreon patrons, the Web Demons.
If you join the Web Demons, you'll get our weekly podcast, show audio, discounts that'll save you way more than $5 a month on books and dice, and so much more. Check out our free podcast episodes right now, including our free interview with Luke Gygax about all things D&D.
If you like our advice for your games, then why don't you come check us out and watch us play?
Yeah, we've got games on Twitch every week, and they're archived on our second YouTube channel, WebDM Plays.
Thanks for watching.
The way that entertainment media shapes our perceptions of history is it's well studied and pernicious.
Yeah.
So.
But we still love those Indiana Jones punches, even though that's not what it sounds like.
Yeah.
Shotgun blasts
right
to the face.
Oh, movies.
Speaking of Mad Max.
Mad Max?
Yeah.
Speaking of movies, Here's Mad Max is one.